Check, mic, check, mic, check, mic, check. How you doing? How you doing? Hello, world.
Hello, hello, hello.
Guess what day it is? It's podcast day, episode 35.
Oh, that's it. Still you ain't gonna say nothing.
Oh, I can't.
Did you hear me?
What'd you say?
Can you hear me?
No, I didn't.
The show is younger than you.
Oh, you know what? Okay, I received that. Give it a couple more days. That's all right. I receive it. We're going to move on. That's Ms.Glam being stank to the oh-so-sweet Mohazel. However, we got a special guest in the building, Dr. Deborah Eichelberger.
Hi.
Yes. Not only is she with a lot of different programs, whether it's Men in Hearts Ministry, she's a resident clinical Christian psychologist with Still Surviving, and she also does couples and family therapy and is developing a program for children. Did I get that all right?
Yes, I'm working on developing a mentoring program with children. I just find that a lot of children don't have good, strong adult relationships. And so much studies show that if children have those strong bonds with adults, it helps them to develop better as people as they get older. So that's the plan.
Yes, ma'am. We're going to put that vibe out there. We're sending you good vibes. It's going to happen.
Good vibes.
But thank you for coming to the show.
Thank you for having me.
And I hear you're going to go in on all three segments. Is that correct?
Yes.
All right. So with that being said, let's get into it. Are you ready, Ms.Glam?
I am ready.
All right. Here we go. Weekly Delight. Okay, so Weekly Delight is where we take a person, place, or thing. It could be an inspirational quote. It can be food. It can be whatever is making us happy, keeping us positive until we get to Friday. And so with that being said, Dr. Deborah, we're going to have you go first today.
So my Weekly Delight is my son taking his first steps.
Aww.
Yes, he is the most adorable thing in the world with the biggest personality. And he's taking his first steps right now. And it's just great to see his independence coming through.
That's what's up. And so he has a big brother.
Yes.
So how is big brother liking little brother?
Big brother is ecstatic. I have to literally separate him from his little brother. Just like,
aww,
leave him alone. And every time his little brother cries, he's like, I don't want my little brother to be sad. It's the most adorable thing. But I have to be the tough mommy and said, look, he let him cry because he's being spoiled.
Well, listen, you make cute babies. So if you make a oops, just, you know where to drop the basket off with the child at.
You got it. I'll just come and visit.
There you go.
Yes.
You're the cool auntie, if anybody
I will
asks.
Be the cool auntie. Yeah, yes. Yeah.
All right, Ms.Glam, what you got?
So my weekly delight is, it's my birthday week! Oh, gosh.
Yay. So, how old are you gonna be?
Younger than you.
Older than the episode?
No, younger than you.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Younger than
so,
you.
So, how's the month been going so far? Has it been really, like...
No, it's been crazy. Oh, but man. It's always crazy. Okay. Back to school, August is a very, ugh. But
if you survive.
I survive until birthday.
And then you get to turn up.
And my birthday fit came. Yay! Ooh,
okay.
So I just got to go buy one more.
Okay. That's what's up. Oh, we got multiples.
Yes.
Okay. That's what's up. Okay.
Day, night before.
Oh, so you got like a week long.
Weekend
long.
Yeah.
Okay. Parade of outfits.
Yes.
Is daddy going to approve of these outfits? Or do we just not post them?
No. Yeah. Yes.
I mean, you're saying that not confident.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with the outfits.
Okay. Just checking.
I'm too old for that now.
Oh, so you are old. Moving on.
For that?
Moving on. Yes. Let me win.
When you have a child in the house who looks at pictures and goes, but you are. Yeah. Okay.
I understand. Well, my weekly delight is also about birthdays. So
mine?
Yes, Ms.Glam. It's about your... No, it's not. So I have two goddaughters, but this goddaughter that lives in South Florida, it's her birthday and she turns the big 9. So I'm super excited for her. I sent her gift, so she has it already, but super excited. I couldn't be there this year. It's all good, but they filled me in and she had a wonderful birthday. all cheers, all smiles, and
did they keep her home from school?
No. They had a party on the weekend. So they just had a party.
Okay.
So no, she didn't get to be that special. She got to go to school. She loved the gift. I will make my way down there eventually, sometime, you know, this fall, to give her a big old hug and kiss.
Look at you. I try. Being a good godmommy.
I try. Listen, I try. It's for the babies. But all right. With that being said, ladies, I appreciate this. Are you ready to get into the topic?
Absolutely.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. So the topic today of dogs and men. Now, let me explain. Devon Franklin. Everybody knows this fine chocolate man, but I still love tech support. How you doing, tech support?
Notice how that was an afterthought.
He said he just bah, just bah. But anyways, so Mr. Franklin has a book out called The Truth About Men, What Men and Women Need to Know. And he uses the metaphor of dogs that needs training as a way to explain this struggle, explores why negative behavior in men can persist, which leads to them to act against their vows, their integrity, and even their character. So we're just going to kind of dive into some of the concepts, you know, kind of peel apart some layers and, you know, kind of see what you guys all think about the book and the concepts. Mm-hmm. What do you think?
Yep, sounds good.
Okay, what's up? So the first question I'm going to throw out there to you guys. In the book, it emphasizes how men struggle with being faithful and mastering their urges. If men feel this is such a struggle, why do you believe in general men have a hard time forgiving women for the things that they themselves struggle with?
That's a great question. And I don't know if it's so much that men have a hard time forgiving, but it takes way more for men to trust mm-hmm. and to open up than it does for women. We naturally just open up and talk. Even if it's just to one person, we don't have that struggle of being able to speak to someone about how we feel. When you have a situation where a man has given a woman that space in his life and she has done to him something that we typically, I guess, would associate with men. It's not to say women don't do what men do, but what we would associate more with a male versus a female, they really take it hard, very, very hard. And it becomes a struggle to ever open that door back up again to women. It can happen, but I find that it's with the man who has been faithful and feels like he has given everything to this woman. This is the first woman he has decided, I'm just going to give my all to. And then she turns around and does this to him.
Sure. Yeah. What about you, Ms. Glam? What are your thoughts?
I mean, I guess I can see exactly how that, what she said as far as not being able to open up or feeling that vulnerable of, but I wonder if it's more of an ego thing.
Okay.
I guess that's what I always thought. Like, men see it more as an ego thing.
Mm-hmm. When they're having the affair?
Yes. Okay. I never looked at it as they have a hard time opening up. I always just went to, I don't know if it's superficial, but their ego won't let them be okay with, and it wasn't enough, or I wasn't enough for her. They struggle with that.
Got it.
But, you know, now I'm leaning towards, you know, that's an interesting point. Maybe it's not the ego thing. Maybe that's what, you know, their soft spot or their comfort zone of, if I focus on the ego, then I don't have to deal with my feelings.
Right. And see, I kind of was in the same feel park as you, but I didn't say it as beautifully as you said it, because I was thinking more of, I know sometimes I think, and I don't know if it's 100% true, but I think men think that when women have an affair, it's that emotional connection mm-hmm. versus with them, there's no emotion in it. I just did it. I don't even like her like that. There's no thinking involved. It's just a physical need or a physical want. And so therefore it dismisses the action because it doesn't take away from what I feel for my family, what I feel for you. I'm a man. Granted, that's no excuse, but use that term, I'm a man, as if, you know, so I'm using what men would say, but, you know, they're just saying like, this is just what we do, versus with women, you thought about it, you know, you had, again, that opening up, but I was going to say like an emotional connection or having that emotional affair, taking it a step further. And so for the man, it's not even about the fact that you may have, you know, smashed somebody. It's the fact that do you care? Do you catch feelings? And I think men think that women are, and it might be true, I don't know, but I think they think women are more capable of catching feelings versus them. They don't catch feelings. That was my thought. And I mean, it's generalizing because I still think that it could work both ways in different scenarios, if that makes sense.
Absolutely. And I think one thing that has to be taken into consideration, and this is shown through studies, of course, I'm not saying this is an absolute truth. Nothing in science is absolute. But there is a lot of studies that show that women, when they have sexual relations, for the most case, they have formed some type of an emotional connection to the person or some type of relationship. Men can have the ability to shut down that part of their brain and just do the deed because men are, they are attractive physically. They see something, they want it. And I think that's what Devon was bringing out in his work when he was talking about lust being a selfish impulse. Men are more impulsive. Women stop, they think, they strategize. And I think what makes it even more the case is when you're in a relationship, a woman is not looking for someone else if she's happy in her relationship. Mm-hmm. A man can just have that lustful one time. I see her. She looks good. I want to smash that. And it has nothing to do with relationship at all. And I like another doctor, Dr. Chapman, where he talks about the fact that women need to be empowered because we have the ability to control the narrative of our relationships. And it goes back to, and I hope that this is okay, the fact of why God said that when you are married, to not deprive your mate of that. Because sex is a very important part of any relationship.
Absolutely.
If a man is feeling satisfied.
Is, I didn't mean to cut you off, but tech support is like, yup, but keep going.
So a man will always see a woman and be like, she's beautiful. I wonder. Just like we see Idris Elba, we see Jason Momoa. We're
won't
like,
do
ooh,
it.
I wonder. Do it. I wonder. But if we're satisfied in our relationship, we're like, yeah, okay. I can think about it, but I don't stay on it because I'm getting satisfied in my relationship. Whereas if you haven't touched me in 4 weeks and Kendrick at work has been looking at me and leaving little flowers on my table, and you're like, you know, Kendrick has been looking kind of nice lately.
Work husband.
I hate that title. Work husband and work wife. But it is the idea that men are more physical. Women are more emotional. So if we as women are not feeding our man's physical needs and he's not feeding our emotional needs, we're going to look outside. And it is easier for a woman to forgive a male sexual infidelity because subconsciously we know they like to have sex. And sometimes they're not thinking with their top brain, they're thinking with their lower brain. But for the female, she has to have had that comfort level to be able to open herself up.
So like now, that. When you say this, is it coming from a more scientific point of view? Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay.
So
okay.
Just looking not from biology sciences, but from psychology sciences and from studies looking at different researches into the propensity for people to cheat or to have extramarital affairs and just surveying those people. And when you look at what are some of the major things that people say that they could deal with and that they couldn't deal with, we find that men cannot deal with the fact of their significant other having an extramarital affair because we as females are internal. We take in everything and internalize it, think about it, kind of sit on it before we make decisions.
Right.
And for men, they are more impulsive. They can just make decisions without stopping to think, what could this possibly have an impact on? And it's for us to learn how to do that. Women need to sometimes be more impulsive, but men also need to be able to control that. Mm-hmm. And it's just learning from each other. That's why we fit so well together. The woman can temper the man's impulsive, but the man can help her to be more excited, more let's go do things.
And what helps, or I guess, what makes men and women that way? Is it like nurture versus nature? Like, what is it that, is it just naturally in us to be that way?
Is it in our DNA, that's, or do we learn question. It? You know what I mean?
You know, that's been the consummate argument in psychology, nature versus nurture. I have the tendency of believing it's a combination of both. That we as females, we have a vagina. Our vaginas are inside.
Amen.
They're not outside. So we take in things. We have things grow inside us.
Stop. I'm going to look at my vagina totally differently. Keep going. I'm sitting there like, did I just catch a gem?
Real? So, keep going. Tech support, when you see her in the mirror, like, and the mirror's down there and she's just looking, now you know why.
Keep going. I'm sorry. Okay. I had to catch my life. I just got my life off that. Go ahead.
No problem.
We can stop the show.
So we take in things. We tend to be more cautious when we think and do things. Like, even if you look at a male baby girl, a male baby and a female baby, the male baby is ready to jump off. The female baby is like, is this cool? Can I do this? The male baby's jumped and gone and just running. The female baby is taking her time because we take in things. The men have penises. They're hanging all out. So it's like, whoo, free for all. Let's do what we want to do.
Tech support nodded like, yep, I co-signed that.
So men are like,
no, like did you that. Catch your yes. life? Yes.
I'm telling
you're
you.
You're welcome back anytime.
So men quarter? Jump and think after. Women think and then jump. So with that combination, we also get socialized that way. Girls are socialized to be more responsible. Take care of yourself. Keep yourself clean. Don't act a certain way. Act ladylike. Be quiet. Be studious. All of these different things. The males, however, are socialized to be aggressive. Be exuberant. Don't be soft. Be hard. Be rawr. You know, that inner lion should be coming out of you. You know, we don't want our boys to cry. We don't want our boys to show quote unquote feminist ways because you're a male. You have to be this macho thing. And unfortunately, that leads to when we become adults and we're saying, well, we want a sensitive man. We want a man who understands our emotions, but they have been browbeaten since a child. You don't show emotions. You don't cry. The only emotion you're allowed to show is anger. Gems. And so,
blame his mother.
Blame daddy too, because daddy said, I'm not raising a punk in my household. And it's like, it's not a bad thing. We are to complement each other. So a female can be excited and exuberant and she's not masculine. A male can be emotional and vulnerable, but he's still masculine. And it's the coming together to bring that, to bridge that gap. So I have a little bit more of this, you have a little bit of more of that, but I have a bit of me and you have a bit of me. It's the yin and the yang. They're not supposed to be separate. They're supposed to come together to complement each other.
So now, let me ask you. So when Mr. Franklin mentions in his book about the concept about mastering the dog.
Yes.
You know, controlling your urges. So you, from based on what I'm hearing, is it safe to assume that, because I know we kind of talked back and forth and I don't know anymore. I'm so turnt on this conversation. But like, I know we were kind of on the fence of wondering, like, did he just write this book as an excuse for men to cop out on, you know what I mean? Right. And so I kind of want to know your point of view. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you still stand on some, I'm speaking out of pocket, but I'll say for me, when I originally heard it, the one thing I did like about the book is that he does force his men to say, you need to be accountable for your actions. However, I felt by him labeling the urges by saying, you know, this is the dog, this is the urges.
It's natural and you all, you know, all men have it. He kind of like said, he provided an out. It's an excuse. Right. I'm a man. Right. So, you know, it was like, this is just natural. I'm meant to, you know, I want to cheat and I just can't help it. I have these urges in me. Like, I did feel like he was kind of putting that behavior of, it's the normal for me.
Right. If your man does it, just excuse it. It naturally happens. So I just wanted to know your point of view from it. Does he have a point to it? Is it safe to say we were on the fence together? We were on the fence of saying, did this dude just put out a book for the men so they can have an excuse to just be like, baby girl, I cheat because it's just natural. Just read Mr. Franklin's book. Right. It's in the book. And, you know, I just felt like he was doing a cop out, but I don't know. You're starting to make me change my mind.
Well, I originally, when I heard his story, because I saw the interview before I read some of the excerpts of the book, And he himself addressed that in one of his interviews. He said that it could be interpreted that he's trying to give men a cop out. And indeed, it sounds that way. And regardless of, some men will use it for that purpose. And these are the ones that haven't done the work to understand who they truly are. But I believe that what he was saying is, you cannot change until you come to terms with what your issue is. And that's what this book does. It's saying, men, you have a problem and you need to recognize that you have the problem so that you can work on it. As a therapist, we cannot help someone change unless they recognize that they have a problem. And that's what I think he's doing with this book. He's saying, guys, you have an issue with lust. That's what he termed the dog. The right. dog is supposed to represent the lust.
Right, right.
You have the master who is represented of love. And if you can develop the love part of you and bring down the lust in you, you overcome those issues that you have. So some men will take it, and that's because it's not just a male thing. People in general, if someone is going to say, you have this issue, you can't help it, we'll use it as an excuse, yeah. no matter
that
what.
That victim mentality.
Right. It's the victim. Fair. Exactly. But when someone can take this book and say, you know what? I didn't realize this was my issue. Then you can say, because this is my issue, you and I, if they're in a relationship, or I am now going to work on this issue so that I can make myself better.
Right, 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 right. Okay, that's fair. You know, and to be clear, I know that when he was talking about mastering this dog, I know it wasn't just limited to just physically cheating. I know he was saying things like, you know, putting your work before your family,
yes.
or mm-hmm. gambling. So this dog or these urges, it can be anything. But, right. you know, most of the men that when we were watching, like, the interviews and things like that, when they would call in and they were agreeing from the standpoint of cheating. So that's why we were wanting to know.
Right. And I hope that when men and women read this book, they realize that he's not only talking about cheating from a physical perspective, because you can have a whole relationship in your head with someone.
Yeah.
You, yes, can, you can have that's an true. Issue, an addiction to drugs
your
and
book
alcohol.
Boyfriends? Your book boyfriends?
That don't count. Sorry. That don't count.
No phase. Okay.
Drugs or alcohol could become your mistress.
True.
Gambling can become your mistress. Your job, just the work itself, can become a mistress, and vice versa. So he talks about the fact that lust is a selfish impulse for self-fulfillment by any means necessary, even if that means the detriment to your family or whomever it is that you're in a relationship with or whomever it is you're connected to. So again, it goes beyond just husband and wife, boyfriend and girlfriend, but it goes to family relationships. It goes to community relationships. All of these different things are impacted when only focus is on yourself. I think that he could have done better instead of saying dog and master by simply focusing on self versus others, because that's essentially what it's
right.
about.
Yeah.
It's when I love, I put those people before myself.
Right.
It's the idea of only thinking of the others or only thinking of myself. And you have to have that balance, which I really need to read his book fully to see if he talks about that. But he hasn't spoken about that in his interviews, which I would like to say to people, you still have to have that balance. It's not just all about everyone else and you completely neglect yourself. You still have to think about yourself. Mm-hmm. You have to find that balance between, I love and I give all of this to my family, I give this to my spouse or my partner, but I also need to make sure I'm taking care of myself. Because if I'm sick,
yeah,
I can't help anybody
else.
And
why do you think people struggle with that? Because I do, like, I see a lot of people, they struggle with that balance. They either give it all, they either give too much or give too less.
Right. Yeah.
But it's very hard for people to find that balance.
Yeah, I know personally in myself, I've struggled with that as well. Just figuring out the balance of, and then I usually will, the only balance I can do is when I give too much to one, then I'll just, okay, slow up and then give more to the other. And then it's just almost like as the seesaw's going up, I try to just slide to the other side to catch it before it falls. Like that's the only way. But yeah. What is a proper balance that you think?
I think the proper balance is when you are doing things for the other people in your life, you also find joy in what it is that you're doing. If you find it to be a struggle, if you find that you are frustrated, if you find that you feel depleted and you feel down after you have done all of this for others, that means you're not giving yourself enough time. So the idea of saying no is very difficult for certain types of people. And it could go back also to how they were raised. It was, if you were raised in an environment where they said, you all think of other people, you're always thinking of yourself, being selfish is a horrible thing, you shouldn't be selfish, you shouldn't be this, you shouldn't be that. So you find it hard to say no because you're so worried about people seeing you as this selfish, self-centered person that you just don't ever want to think about yourself. And no one taught you, you can love yourself at the same time giving that same love to others. You can find fulfillment by what it is that you do for others. The Bible says, love your neighbor as yourself. Mm-hmm. And many people take that and construe the word to say, well, you have to think of others before yourself. No, listen to what that verse says. Love your neighbors as yourself. Meaning, I have to love them like I love myself.
Right.
So if I don't love me, I cannot effectively love other people. I'm just doing things for people to try and keep a face, to try and make sure that I'm not looking like a certain thing, but I'm not truly loving them. And then I'm left frustrated and depressed at the end of the day, or anxious or tired, because I've just given all of this to everybody. No one has given back to me, including myself. And now I'm left feeling like, why alone am I doing all of these things?
Mm-hmm. All these emotional things.
Yep.
Wow. Okay. Gems, my man.
Self-love is important.
Self-love, self-care. I receive that.
So don't talk about me on my pamper me days.
I don't. Listen, I don't. Listen, don't talk about me on my, I'm going to sit on the couch and smash these chips and watch Netflix. That's self-care too. Okay? But let me ask you this, Deborah. In the book, in the interviews, he mentioned, Mr. Franklin mentioned the importance of not vilifying a man who is sharing his truth. And because it could prevent him from being able to be vulnerable if we're attacking him in this way.
Yeah.
We want to know your expert opinion on how should a woman or anyone should handle a situation where the man is delivering their truth, because, again, it's not easy for them to be vulnerable and try to do it in a way that doesn't cause pain or anger towards them.
That's a great question.
Especially when they're... the message being received is one that's going to cause you pain and anger.
Correct. Yeah. Correct. Correct.
The first thing, I think Mr. Franklin said it in an interview, but it was something I've always said in my therapy sessions with couples. I've always said to the woman, if he came and said this to you, that's a big deal. Because if somebody is going to do something to someone, they're not going to let you know that they're doing what they're going to do. If he's taking that risk, because it is a risk. Whenever you're telling someone an ugly truth, whether it's in your job, whether it's in your family, whether it's in school, whatever the place might be, to tell someone the ugly truth is a risk, because you have no idea how that person is going to react. Yeah. Something as simple as, hey, you're gaining weight, this could affect your health. All a person could hear is, you call me fat, so you think I'm ugly. I haven't even said that out of my mouth. Right. But it's because we clam up and we get defensive. Mm-hmm. We don't take the time to listen. Yep. So the first thing is, if a person is coming to you and saying, I have something to tell you that I know could cause you pain, but I would rather you know the truth, we have to take the time to be able to sit down and just say, okay, let me hear what this person has to say. And the one thing that always works in my sessions thus far, thank you, Lord, that works so far is I tell them, don't say anything for 5 minutes. Just sit and hear what it is that they just said to you. Think about what it is that they said. Go through all of the screaming rants in your head, because you never realize how long 5 minutes is until you can't talk for 5 minutes. 300 seconds becomes very long. To just sit and let that marinate, because it now allows you to stop and think, how am I going to respond to this? Because he could have just let you find out, or she could have just let you find out, but they loved you and cared for you enough that they said, I have to tell you this. The next step would be, how are we going to work on this together? Because even if one person in the relationship cheats, it's not only just their issue. It's something else that you also are not doing. And that's the hard part to come to, because you just want to throw off on the other person to say it's your issue, you go and handle it.
Right.
But it has to be something that happened that caused them to go that way. And either you're going there to support them or you're going there to work on your own self. That's how you have to approach it. Approach it from how do we fix this versus vilifying.
Blaming. As
it's, because blaming does nothing.
Right.
It just destroys. And we're not looking to destroy each other. We're looking to build up.
But how do you, like, you've gotten this bad news, whatever it is. How do you know you want to work on it right then? You haven't had time to process it.
But you still don't have to attack.
No, I'm not saying attack, but like, how do you, like, is it okay to take time to deal with it and not, like, I can't address this right now. I just need time.
Can that be received?
Absolutely. Okay. And that's what they have to, the person who's delivering the message has to also be willing to do, is to receive what it is that that person needs. Okay, let's do an example. Tech support tells Mohazel, hey, so, you know how we've been trying to work on this child thing? Well, you know, surprise. But he wouldn't say it like that. But I'm just saying, tech support would have to understand, I need to give her time. I can't just say, okay, here it is, now forgive me.
No, you can go to the other lady's house. Keep going.
But it is, and that's why sometimes...
That's fixing the problem. You got to go. No, I'm just
This is true. This is true. But it also, you have to know your relationship.
Yeah, sure.
Can you give that information to that person, just you and that person? Or do you need a mediator who can help diffuse the situation so you don't say something you not
tech support don't call say? Me because you're gonna die die a slow painful death.
Oh gosh, we're being messy, but keep going.
Absolutely. That's what it's all about.
So now let me ask you a random you were talking about listening versus just hearing someone.
Yes.
Since it seems like there is some type of science to this, are men just as capable as being good listeners as women? Only reason I'm asking is because they always say the women are such good listeners. But is it in fact that men can be just as great at listening as well? Like when you do your sessions, do you find that, you know, I know you said it worked, but do you find that it's harder for men or for women or for both to fully hear each other and not be in their head over what they're going to say next or be in their head over what did you just do? And they're not ready to, you know, talk calmly and, like you said, fix it.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's not about whether it's the man or the woman. It's about if the woman was the one who stepped out on the relationship, you have to teach the man to stop and listen, because the only thing that he's going to go to is to start blaming. It's a natural human thing. We're trying to protect our heart. We're trying to protect our emotions. We're trying to protect ourselves. So it becomes a survival mode on an emotional level.
Sure.
So whatever I can do to not hurt, that's what I'm going to do. And sometimes that becomes fighting through words. Because, you know, you have flight or fight or freeze, that response. So some people just freeze up. They're like, I can't say anything. Then you have the people that just want to run. Just like, you know what, I'm gone. And they leave. And then you have the ones that want to fight. So that 5 minutes of just stopping.
Glam. I'm a fighter.
That would be
I love it. That 5 minutes gives you time to overcome your initial fight, flight, or freeze response. And then once that information is given, then you say to the affected party, what is it that you need right now? And whatever it is that they need at that moment, we help to give it to them with the contingency that we're going to come back on this. Not just the I'm gone, don't ever talk to me again, but to be able to come back together after you have done what you needed to kind of help bring down the hurt and the pain and the emotions that you're feeling at that moment in time.
Now, for the ones that... like that you're helping or you've experienced, if for those who've gone through therapy before or they've gone through, not training, but gone through classes or things that help them to be more in tune with themselves. Well, no, just to be more in tune with themselves, okay, or, you know, gone to therapy before. Is it easier to, I guess, get them to hear or get them to recognize, you know, I guess, unhealthy behavior?
That's a great question, Ms. Glam. Actually, the ones who have gone through it are harder to work with than the ones who have never done it before. And it's simply because it becomes this, well, I already know it type mentality, if that makes sense. When it's brand new, they're so hungry for it that they'll just take anything that you say and they're willing to try. It's okay. Those who have tried it and it didn't work, then they are kind of more cynical.
Okay.
Yeah, when it comes to it. It really becomes showing them a different path, showing them where maybe they were doing it incorrectly, and if they did it the right way, then they would be okay. Or giving them new information that they've never heard of before that makes them more willing to do what the work requires.
Interesting.
Yes, ma'am.
I would have thought the opposite. That's very interesting. I wouldn't have thought, like, I would have thought they would be more
acceptive.
Yes, like, you know, I've gone through this. This is, I guess, if they had a good experience, then maybe so. But, like, if they've had a bad experience, I can see that. I can see them being more like, yeah, you know what you're talking about. Like, I've done this and it don't work.
Right.
Do you find that more men, since you started doing your practice, are finding it acceptable to go and use therapy as a means, or it just still seems like it's not as many? I know you're saying about, you know, if they went before, but for the new ones that come to it, do you see that men are being open to this or they're resistant?
I find that typically the men are coming because their wife told them to. I haven't had a lot where it was the husband who reached out. It's like very rare occasions where I have that, but it is typically the woman that's reaching out, saying that there's issues in the relationship that they want to work on. And what I have to provide for the men is a safe space,
right?
Because they've had so many arguments with women in their life that they're like, oh, here's another woman who's going to tell me what I need to do. And letting him realize, I'm not here to tell you what to do. I want to hear your side of the story. And when he realized that I'm unbiased, that I will go to his wife and say, this is what you did wrong. Did you hear what your husband just said? It makes them realize I'm finally in a space where someone is listening to what it is that I have to say. And that's when the real work starts, when they finally realize that this is a safe space for me to be able to talk.
That makes sense.
Men want a space to talk. Like, I don't think people really recognize it, but men are just as chatty as women.
Yes, they are.
Once they are in a comfortable space.
Just as gossipy and chatty.
They just have to be
more
comfortable.
Exactly. Yeah,
yeah.
I agree.
Once they're comfortable, just like an introverted person, they can be very chatty.
Yep.
They just have to be in an environment that they feel comfortable, that they don't feel judged, that they feel they can just be themselves. And we as women can provide that for men. And I think that's why we are the more emotional ones, so that we can give this macho man a space to be himself that no one else ever needs to know about and shouldn't leave those confines.
Got it. That's why you love me, Ms. Glam.
Why?
Because you feel comfortable in a safe space to talk.
No. Not even a little bit.
Listen, I could go all day with you. But, you know, we do kind of have to wrap
up. You cannot steal her accent.
Oh, my gosh. No.
Don't.
Oh, gosh. But, you know, I am about accents. And I'm just like, tell me more. But we do have to wrap it up. So let's close with, and we'll, of course, obviously, guest honor go first. Kind of close with some thoughts on, you know, what advice would you give to men that, you know, have these urges that, and again, it doesn't have to be the cheating. It could be of any urge, whether it's gambling or drugs or that. What should be obviously awareness is the first step, but who should they talk to first? Should they, you know, maybe seek counseling first? Should they, you know, maybe open up the truth to their family? Where should they go to first in regard to guidance? Obviously, the number one answer is you need to get on your knees and pray. Right? That's fair.
Yes.
But, you know, what about those that aren't religious? what would be, you know, your advice to any man or woman? Who should they turn to first when they finally own up to what's going on? Where do they go? What do they do?
It's going to be an interesting answer. Don't go to people that know you.
Okay.
And the reason why is because we tend to surround ourselves with people that will appease us and not necessarily be honest with us. Unless you're just that person who has surrounded yourself with those type of people that's just going to tell you right off the bat, open and honest, cutthroat to this point, then yes. But I find that majority of people surround themselves with people that's going to appease them and want to diverge from confrontation. No, they don't want to confront it. So you have to, one, find somebody that you feel comfortable in their space enough to let it all out. And that's where a therapist can come in. They're unbiased. They don't know anything about you. They're just hearing your story. So they can give a different perspective from what it is that has happened. They don't have any past experiences with you. It's just all fair game. And if you're in a relationship and it's something within the relationship that you're struggling with, bring that partner with you. Let them know, this is what I am struggling with. And I'm always an advocate of using I statements. Pull it back to yourself. Because the one thing that you can't argue with is how I feel. So if I feel this way, if this is my truth, this is my issue, right, and I'm not blaming you, I'm saying this is on me, it becomes more easier for you to accept what's happening and want to help. Because something that Mr. Franklin said is that open honesty takes the sting out of difficult situations. And I find that to be very true. When a partner can say, I'm struggling with pornography because I didn't feel like I could be sexually gratifying to the person. So I did that to learn things and now I'm stuck in it and I need help. You would then say, I feel you and I'm going to help you because I want the relationship to work. I find that the relationships that don't work out is because you have spent so much time arguing and bitching and complaining and throwing off and cussing each other out and calling each other's names for so long that when you finally get honest, you're like, well, why didn't you tell me this in the first place? But you have now hurt me so much.
Tired her.
I don't want this anymore. I'm done. This was like the last straw that broke the camel's back. Instead of starting with, this is what I'm struggling with. This is what I need. And I don't feel like I'm getting this. So this is why I turned to this. And now I have to work on this, but this is what I need for you to do. If I can tell a quick story.
Sure, go for it.
All honesty, I'm on my second marriage. In my first marriage, I said a lot about what it is that I wanted. And my ex would hear it all the time. Just me constantly saying, you're not doing this enough for me. I need this from you. I need this from you. And I never got it. And it came down to when our marriage ended that he said, I don't think we should have ever been together in the first place because what you need is just ridiculous. And it made me become very not willing to share what I want, thinking that my wants and my desires were just so surmountable and unrealistic that any relationship that I get into in the future would not be able to satisfy that need, that I just have to forget about it. But here I am now in my second marriage with a husband who loves to talk about emotions and loves to communicate. And I am now stuck having to relearn how to talk about my emotions because I had to train myself to shut down.
Yeah.
And he's like, stop shutting down. I hate when you shut down. I want to hear what it is that you're saying. And realizing that that need that I had was not unrealistic. I just did not have the partner to satisfy that need. And sometimes in relationships, it's just hard to say, this is a need that I have. I need this. And for you to say, I can't provide that. So either we're going to work on ways to teach you how to meet my need, or we let it go. Because you should not have to suffer not having your need met. A want is whatever. I want you to have 6-packs, but that's not going to kill this situation. I would like for you to have a chiseled chest like Jason Momoa, but at the end of the day, Jason Momoa's chest or a six pack is not going to help me feel good.
No, it's not.
I need you to be there for me when the world has dragged me down. That you are my comfort. You are my solace. I couldn't get that in my first relationship because he did not have the capacity, nor did he want to learn how to do it. And now I'm with someone who has that capacity. And that's what I would say. I would say find that person that you can be open and honest with, who most likely does not know you very well, but you know could give sound advice. Own what it is that you need. Own what it is that you're struggling with, and bring that other person that you're in a relationship with you, using yourself and saying, this is me. This is my issues. This is what I'm going through. And I would like for you to help me through this as I amend whatever hurt this has caused you as well.
That's some dope stuff. How do
So wait. You're going to be mad, but I got questions. So
don't even worry about it. Listen, we've agreed. I think we agreed we're not even going to do our close out.
I'm not. I have questions.
One more question.
Yeah, no, I got two.
Go ahead. Okay. Do it.
So the
we
first,
love you, by the way, yes, just so you know.
Absolutely.
So the first one is like, because you mentioned going to therapy. And while like my head agrees, my heart, you know, my emotion goes, you better not bring me to therapy and then drop a bomb on me like in front of another person. Like
I can't act out because I'm not going to act
out.
Oh, no.
I'm going to act out.
I'm the opposite. I won't show out in front of company.
I show out in front of company.
I'm going to take it to the house.
My mama didn't raise me that way. My mama, you know.
Is going to see us on the news. Is that couple? Did she just burn down the house? Sorry. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
So I guess I agree, but part of me is hesitant. Like, don't bring me to therapy to drop a bomb
on
me.
One-on-one, like he needs to go to therapy?
No. Honestly, what I would say, Ms. Glam, is, again, it depends on the relationship. So that's why I said for each person, it's going to be different. If I know you, then I know I can come to you first because I know you're going to act a fool. So let me come and talk to you first about what's going on and what it is that I'm doing to start the work, if that makes sense.
Okay, yeah. Yeah. Because I guess I would see it as a betrayal. I guess the reason why I would show out more if it was dropped on me in therapy is I would see it as a betrayal or trust, or not trusting me to tell me directly. So therefore, that's worse. So I'm going to show out there versus show out when you come to me because I want you to trust me.
Right. And I agree with you. I'm like that as well, too. I feel that I have presented myself in such a way that you should be able to come to me first.
Yes.
And say, baby, this is what's going on. And I would like for us to do this together. I'm cool with that. And I think that you have presented yourself in that way, Ms. Glam. So I wouldn't recommend it for somebody with you, per se. And so that's why I specified you have to find
the
person that you want to be.
I'm going
to
be honest.
Yes.
Here's how I say it. I respect you coming to me, but I'm going to chop you either way. We can do this in front of this therapist.
You need company.
Or we can do it at the house.
You need company. So she ain't right.
We do it at the house, so I might get off because I might have an alibi. I'm joking. I'm being messy, of course. I'm being messy.
But that's a good question.
What was your second question? Go ahead. Listen, we done forego. You the first guest to make us forego our own thought.
I'm sorry.
Gonna compare to what you're saying. Well, gems. No, then, I'm serious. It's gems.
Yeah, and then my second question was more of because you touched on a very important part on sometimes your significant other does not have that capacity to give you what you need.
Yeah.
Right.
But how do you know when it's they can't do it versus
you gotta give them the time?
Yes.
Because sometimes they have to know that they can trust you, right? That's a very good question. You got to build this trust, build this level of allowing them to feel that they can be vulnerable, chipping at their wall.
Absolutely.
So how long is too long? Like, how do you know when it's never going to happen?
Yeah.
That's a good question. I like that question.
The first thing that you have to look at, I don't think it's a timing situation so much as watching the progress.
So I can't say you got 6 months.
No.
No. You can't give an ultimatum. You got 6 months to get it together. No.
Here's a study guide.
Call Miss Deborah.
I feel and I've seen that if I see you working and you're making progress, I can work with that. But if it gets to a point that you're just not seeing any work and they're looking distressed and you can see maybe from their body language or just how they're behaving that they're like, I just can't do this. It's time to have another conversation.
Okay.
And have that honest, I can't. I don't know how to do this. I have no idea. And after you have exhausted all of your options, you can't just, for example, a visual learner, if you're only ever just talking to them and they're saying, I cannot get it, you haven't tried the way that they can learn. So you can't just say, okay, well, we're done. Figure out how is it that you do learn. You learn visually? Cool. Let's switch this teaching mode. So I would say after you have exhausted all the options that you can think of and it just doesn't seem to be getting to the level that you want it to be and you've given it enough time and you guys have come together and talked and said, you know, I think that this is too much for me to handle and we've done all of these different things and it just doesn't seem to work, we might just need to call it quits. And I think sometimes those are probably those 20-25 year marriages that you just see them just separate and you're like, how after 20-25 years you get divorced? And they're like, but there's my best friend. And I still don't have that concept at all. My ex is not my best friend at all. But
he ain't,
I think,
mine it, either.
No. But I think it's those relationships where really they just could not meet those real significant areas of their life. They've spent the time, they've tried it, they stayed together for the kids, and they're just like, you know, this is more important right now. I don't think that this is working for me, and I don't want to deprive you nor myself of the ability to have a fulfilling relationship. Now, of course, the Christian side of me is saying anything with prayer and fasting and working out can work. Mm-hmm. But for those that don't profess that type of faith, that's what you have to do. Have those open, honest discussions without throwing off. And don't make the person feel bad. Some people are just not wired to think and behave in those ways. Mm, and that's okay. Find the person that fits you.
That's just not your person.
That's just not your person.
And it's not nothing wrong with
them.
There's
nothing wrong with them. There's nothing wrong with you. You just have to find the person that fits you.
We knew that, but to own up that there's nothing wrong with them.
Yes.
It's going to be a hard pill as well. But I received that. Thank you so much.
Oh, it was a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
I felt like I got my life.
Yes.
I got to shape up. Meanwhile, tech support is...
I think we need to have like part two, part three, part four.
You understand what I'm saying?
Well, like, I am here. I am ready to go.
You are definitely going
to
be brought back.
Yes, ma'am. I would love to
come back.
We will
find a topic for you every quarter when we got to get our life. It ain't even for the audience. We appreciate you listening, but it's for us. Real quick before we move on, where can people out there, you know, in the Jacksonville area find you?
So because I am a one-woman show and I am not technologically based, I have an email. Okay. And I have a phone number.
Desk connections.
I'm working on the whole Facebook and other stuff. I don't even have IG. Like, I only have Facebook as a social media.
Okay.
That's it. You can connect with me by messaging me through Facebook. It's my name, Deborah Eichelberger. You can email me at mendedhearts@gmail.com. And you can also call me at 904-250-5017. And again, I am a Christian therapist, so all of the work that I do is from a scriptural biblical standpoint, but I'm not going to beat you over the head with the Bible. I'm not trying to convert you to Christianity, but I'm using those Christian principles in the therapy. And I think what helps a lot too is I'm not diagnosing you as well. So I'm not going to tell you you're bipolar or you have major depression. That's not what I do.
Slam you crazy.
I'm just here to do the work with you.
I was born this way.
We thank you.
Thank you so much.
No worries. So, ladies, with that being said, let's get into the petty word of the day. After we got all that awesomeness, we're going to go straight into the petty word of the day. Hey, we ain't ashamed. We're going to go into this.
Right.
We're going to soldier through. But petty word of the day is where we are going to take a nice new vocabulary word out the dictionary, and we decided to learn about it, study it, and put it in a nice sentence, but we do it with a twist on the show. Usually we like to put it in pretty petty sentences. So with that, guest honors first.
Okay, so this is a total 180 from what we were talking about. But it's all in fun and love. But my word is expeditious.
Expeditious
to me means to be prompt, to be quick, and to the point. And so my petty sentence would be, my homegirl said that her boyfriend is expeditious in the bed. That's not a good thing.
She does have layers of petty. I love it. I love it. She was like, let me get your life and now let me bring it back. Ms. Glam, would you like to go next or would you like me to go next?
I can go. I actually decided to use one of those long, confusing words again.
Yay. You starting to get on my level. I love
it. Yes. So my word is aneum-gatherum.
Aneum-gatherum.
Yes. And it means a miscellaneous collection.
Mm. Ooh.
Mohazel is obsessed with all things British, so our podcast room is an omnium gatherum of British themed pieces like Big Ben, the red telephone booth.
So true, darling.
Elton John,
so true.
Her bad accents.
I'm working on it. Watch Misfits a couple more times and I'll get it in, love.
No.
Right? No. Okay. Well, I try. So with my petty word, Belly's peer, a person of great wit or intellect.
Oh, it's me again. Oh, you're so sweet.
I decided not to go petty in honor of our guest because I didn't know if she was going to go petty. And then she went in. So now I feel really horrible because I'm like, oh, she's not going to be mean. So I'll be nice. Anyways, I was going to say I really enjoyed today sitting at a table of Belly's peer type women.
Oh,
thank you. Minus you?
Huh?
Minus you?
Yeah, sure. If that makes you feel better. It's not really, but
Minus you?
I caught what you said. I'll let you have it. I'm going to keep with this little, you know, nice tone. So, but yes, again, we thank you. Thank you so much. The pleasure was all ours.
I appreciate it.
No worries. Ms. Glam.
Yes.
Do you have anything left?
Yes, actually, I got some more questions.
Go ahead. I know, right? So we're going to wrap this up, but you stay right in the studio because we got some, I got some questions about test support. Like, we need, no, sorry. But we appreciate you. But anything else to say?
Until next time.
And we are out.